just wanted to say that today is the opportunity that you have to hear an episode unlike you've ever heard before. Yes, my friends, it is Dick Duquesne in Tales of a Private Dick, Episode 1, The Castrato, written by none other than Zach Green and Ari Stidham. Embark on this live journey recorded at Open Space in Los Angeles, California. Enjoy and beware.
It's 3:15. There's no one in the place except you and me.
The name's Dick. Dick Duquesne. I'm a dick. A private dick. A detective with a penis. I'm the best in my field, and I know you can't see them, but take my sweet word for it that my eyes are as blue as the cool, cool pools of Aquafina herself. Now that you know a bit about me, let's move on to my case. When looking back on a case such as this one, I think all I can do is scratch my head. Sometimes, as a detective, you realize it's all about luck and persistence. I find myself opening a door, and then I have a drink. And then I open another door. And that door leads to more doors, so naturally, I have another drink. And then pretty soon, I've opened so many and am now surrounded by doors, which are within doors that lead to other doors, and I'm just drinking, wondering which door is the right door. I mean, literally, any door that there is could be a door that warrants opening. So, usually, I just open whatever door is in front of me. I'll open it, and sometimes inside is a man, in which case I'll talk to him. If he's not the man I need, well, I go out that door and open up the door next door. See who's in there. Not him? Maybe it's the first guy again. Who knows? On to the next, and so on, until hopefully one of these days, one of these doors leads to a door that contains my man. And that, my friends, is justice. But what if I'm not so lucky? What if I end up opening all the wrong doors only to find nothing at all? That's the case? Then wowie. I just hope I'm not on the wrong side of all those knobs. It was a Tuesday morning, late June. I awoke to my alarm clock and tossed my nicotine patch from the night before and got one from my drawer. My head was killing me. I either needed a new patch or 12 guns in my mouth, waiting to blow my brains out of the side of my head when I say go. Damn. I don't think I miss anything so much as a cigarette. A visitor. I never planned for visitors. I peered out the window and looked down. There she stood, a nun, in classic church wools, frantic in a gait, sad in her face. I let the lady up. So tell me, sister, what brings you to my office?
Well, I pass this building every day on my way back from the grocery runs.
I see. Whiskey?
No, it's 8:45 in the morning, but thank you.
Go on.
Well, see, I run the orphanage down the block, in the back of the 6th Street Church. Maybe you'd know it better as Pastor Tom's church.
Sorry, I've never heard of it.
You've never heard of Pastor Tom? He's the Elvis of Burbank.
Whoa! Whoa, I'm the Elvis of Burbank. Now, just who the hell does she think she is?
Anyway, I run the orphanage, and a few years ago, one of our eldest disappeared.
Disappeared?
Yes. See, the children who still haven't been adopted are taken care of by the older kids. The boys tend to run away around 15. Some stay, some girls join the sisters and move to the nunnery. The girls who aren't taking LSD in vans and still have all their teeth are sort of like den mothers. And last year, our den mother, Maya, disappeared.
Well, you waited an awfully long time to find a private penis, dick.
Listen, it was 4 days before her 18th birthday. She just stopped showing up. We looked everywhere, put up flyers, went to the police, but they're the most racist men I've ever spoken with in my entire life, and they pushed our case aside.
I'm sorry to hear that. But I don't think there's anything I can do for you, sister. This just sounds like a missing persons report.
The thing is, I saw her this morning.
Then why are you here?
She was all drugged up, being taken in by the police. She was turning tricks.
Not the magic kind, I presume.
No. No, I, no.
Sounds like she's seen a lot of magic wands.
She's like a daughter to me, so...
Yep. I'm sorry. That's on me.
Yes. Yes, this is very serious.
Well, can I still be on board?
Sure. Just please don't do that anymore.
Noted. This woman perplexed me. Maybe it was that the whiskey hadn't hit me yet. Or maybe it was that I was raised in a church and the person that taught me to shoot was a tough nun. I knew this case was going to be pro bono, but that was all right. I guess you could say I was emotionally connected.
So you'll start today?
Looks like I've got myself a case, and you've got yourself a dick.
Oh my.
Burbank Police Department. A true eyesore. And it smells like cow shit all over. The funny thing was, it wasn't as easy as it usually is to talk to Maya. Now, Sister Mary wasn't wrong. The cops of Burbank are as racist as my eyes are a callous dark brown. They tend to be hard to deal with if you're a woman or not white, or even if you're black. But today, even I was getting some blatant racism.
Listen, Diquesne, this isn't like any other case you've seen before. And I know you've seen some humdingers.
See what I mean? Racist. Okay, I don't understand why you won't let me in, Lieutenant Garbage.
This isn't just a run-of-the-mill dolly mop on the side of the road.
Then what is it?
It's classified.
Maybe you misunderstand me. I'm a white man.
The secret password.
I know it's scummy, and believe me, the eight loves of my life have differed in race from black to topal. But sometimes you need to lean into the attributes that God gave you.
I can't talk here, Diquesne. Meet me at this address. 9 p.m. tonight.
Before I could say another word, he'd gone. I looked at the piece of paper in front of me. I'd never been to this address before. Was I crazy for doing this? Opening all these doors for a nun who just stumbled in off the street? I walked back to the office to gather my thoughts, and I found myself standing outside the 6th Street Church. Music played as I slowed my gait and looked up at the gothic behemoth. I changed my nicotine patch and pondered. This place took me back to my youth, running through the pews, chasing skirts, my first tongue kiss after communion, building guns with Sister Tracy. Oh, to be a young buck again. I wonder if that firing range is still standing. I'm doing this for Sister Tracy. I'm doing this for the little boys and girls out there who need to learn how it feels to hold the hard steel of a pistol resting in your belt loop as you cruise the town you love. Or how to play gin. Or how to drink whiskey straight up. Or shoot darts. To black out and make sweet love to a real woman. Big time. To never see her again until your friend invites you over for dinner to meet his wife. And then you think, oh boy! You know, stuff you can only really learn from a nun. This one's for you, sister. The house was normal enough. Suburban. I rang the bell. And waiting a good deal of time until the cop from before answered the door.
Glad you could join us, Diquesne. Come in.
I walked into what appeared to be a room of men dressed as ghosts. All men I'd seen before. Officers. A weird ghost party of white officers who ranked highly in the Burbank and Los Angeles police departments. Funny thing was, we weren't even close to Halloween. Lieutenant Garbage took his hood off and handed me my regular.
Whiskey, a whole bottle.
You remembered.
Once a cop, always a cop.
I don't know about that. So let's cut to the chase. I don't want to hold up your ghost party any longer than I have to. Tell me about Maya.
Boys, gather round. This is the dick I told you about. Asking about Maya Brown Jackson.
You're telling him about the Castrato?
Oh, the Castrato?
Tell him, Lieutenant Garbage. Tell him.
You ever heard of the Castrato?
No.
Do you know what a Castrato is?
Can't say that I do.
Well, back in the day, when boys were raised up singing, see, there were these vocal parts in Italy, in operas, for boys. And these parts were way too high for boys to sing, unless they, you know, cut their balls off.
Jesus.
He's been known as a low-level pimp for years around here. Apparently, his parents were crazy. Theater people wanted a girl, a soprano, but got him instead. So before he even hit puberty, they clipped his balls right off. Thing is, he's never really been on our radar. Did a brief stint in Glendale Penitentiary, got out 3 years back, and then some reports start coming in from counties surrounding ours. People coming to the police saying they bought time with these hookers, and they wake up, and their dicks are completely gone.
Gone?
Vanished. Snipped off. They're drugged during the process, and they don't even know it's happening until they come to. Reports up to 13 unsolved cases, but our intel is good that there are as many as 50 men out there who are just too nervous to come out and say it.
Poor bastards.
Where does Maya fit into all this? Don't tell me she's the one donning the shears.
Unconfirmed. She certainly won't talk. Listen, we're trying to keep all of this under wraps. If the papers caught wind that there were dick-snipping hookers around every corner, they'd paint Burbank to be Hollywood's dirty little sister, see? So now you know. Now you're on the inside.
Can I talk to her?
If you can get her to talk, she's all yours.
The next day, they led me to her cell. They'd been keeping her there, leaning on her for information. And Maya, well, let's just say she wasn't the type of cookie you should lean on. She was a tough cookie, so she, well, scratch what I said before about the leaning, because if a cookie was tough, then it is the type of cookie you should lean on. As opposed to a soft, crumbly cookie, she was a tough cookie, so end of metaphor.
I ain't saying a fucking word to no one. About nothing.
Now, Maya, I'm just here to get the story straight. I play nice. I'm not a cop.
Ain't nobody in here actually plays nice. You ought to know that by now. You old as fuck.
Now you listen to me. I transcend time. Why did you leave the church 2 years ago? I could see I wasn't getting anywhere. Maybe this isn't working because I haven't been clear. I was sent here on behalf of the Sixth Street Church.
The church sent you?
Yes.
If they sent you, then you already know I never left the church.
What?
I ain't never lived nowhere besides the church. That's where I live. My family lives there. When I get out of here, I'm going right back there. Because I know the pastor didn't send you. Come in here, ask some questions like, when did you leave? Shit, I never left. Who do you think I am, bitch? You expect me to believe the pastor sent your busted ass up in here?
A nun sent me. Sister Mary.
Look, you got all I got. I said everything I know. I ain't saying a word about shit. I want a lawyer. I want a fucking Powerade. Fuck you.
I trotted down the steps of the jail and looked around. My gut was burning. Had I wasted all my time on some crazy old nun without checking my sources? That's detective work 101. Check your sources, drink, open a door, drink. I made my way back uptown, speeding through Burbank, a man on fire. And I arrived at the Sixth Street Church, cowering in her sight, looming five stories up, a monolith in the Burbank metropolis. I opened the door and my ears were filled with music. The church was empty, except for the band practicing on stage.
Thank you for a great rehearsal. God be with you.
I was about to meet the man that would send me down the rabbit hole, but I didn't know it at that moment.
How may I help you, brother?
The name's Duquesne. Dick Duquesne.
Oh, your office is right by the grocery store here in Uptown Burbank. I pass it all the time on my nightly constitutionals.
That's right, yes. Father?
Pastor! Tom!
Ah, the aforementioned Elvis of Burbank.
Well, I'm no boast, but the Bugle and the Times seem to agree on that title.
I already knew I hated him, but at this moment it was unwarranted. He had done nothing but revoke me of my title and humiliate me on a Saturday morning. Back to the task at hand. I'm actually here on business. I took on a case of disappearing children from a nun on your staff. I was hoping you could answer a few questions and verify her residence and position here for me, as I've seemed to have reached a dead end.
Certainly. I'll be of as much help as I can, Detective.
Is there a nun here by the name of Sister Mary?
Yes. Sweet Sister Mary, what about her?
Yes, sweet, sweet Mary. What are her duties here at the church?
Well, she runs the orphanage.
I see. And would you say she's a capable woman, this Sister Mary, for this position?
Oh, I'd say more than that. She's a very special woman.
And by special, you mean?
Oh, I mean she's very dedicated, loves the children, very smart.
Smart as in wise? Maybe full of aged wisdom? Or
no, just smart. She can recite the whole Bible back to front, from Eli to Christopher. God love her.
And that's about all her memory's good for now, huh?
What?
You know, a bit of senile citizenship. Forgetting her address, misplacing children, catheters and bedpans and all that jazz.
No, Sister Mary thankfully has her health. I have no idea what you're talking about.
I knew now that I was being played. By who? Maya or this so-called Memphis hunk with blue suede shoes? The only thing to do was play right on back. How involved are you in the orphanage process?
Oh, practically not at all. If I'm honest, I only really run Sunday Mass. It's the real moneymaker. Best show in town. You should stop by sometime.
Would you know any of the orphans by name?
Oh, sure I would.
Ever heard of Maya Brown?
Oh, well, look at that. You may just meet some of the children yourself. Here come the teenagers for confirmation class. I'll head back to my study. Don't hesitate to call any time, Detective.
Thanks for your help. I stuck around and found Sister Mary. Ran some timetables with her. State capitals. Just to make sure she checked out. I tricked her with Albany, but otherwise she did fine. Suddenly the only one feeling too old for this shit was me. Aside from mistakenly thinking she had dementia, I was hard-pressed to give her any updates. I felt lost. Off my game. My only inclination was to go back to the prison to see if I could squeeze some more information out of Maya. Little did I know, a plan was forming in the mind of that pastor.
Were you followed?
Nah, shit, man, I wasn't followed.
Do you have the stuff?
Yes, I have the stuff. Man, why are you so adamant on me bringing you stuff like this? Can't you get one of your girls to pick up after themselves?
Just let me see it! Oh, Jesus Christ, it's so small! What the fuck was your sister thinking? I don't want this. Throw it away.
Throw it away? It's a man's penis. You're not at least gonna keep it like you do all the others?
Who am I, Hannibal Lecter? I have taste. I'm not some weirdo.
Whatever, man. I grab the dangles if you tell me to. You pay me, so whatever.
Damn right. And since I am paying you, I have a new task for you.
Ah, shoot.
You know that office a few blocks down? The one next to the roller coaster that says Dick Duquesne, Private Dick?
What is it with all the dicks, man?
He's a detective. Come on. He came in today, and I think he's a little too close to finding out what's really been going on down here. You want more money?
Hell yeah!
Then follow him. Tailor's every move. And here?
Is that a safe? Is that a gun?
Don't act so surprised, kid. Here's 10,000. Go post bail for Maya. Bring her back here. Don't go anywhere else, you hear me? And do it quick before that detective gets to her. I got a feeling our stories aren't matching up.
I'm on it.
The police count this, so it better be precise.
I got it.
Just to reiterate, I was not there for that. I didn't hear any of that, and I wasn't there for it, but I was filled in later about what transpired, so I'm able to fill the gaps here. But I wasn't there. Had I been there, I would have apprehended the pastor there, and it would have been over then and there, but of course it wasn't, because I was not there, okay? I made it to the jail minutes after Maya had departed.
You just missed her. Strangest thing, a little kid just took her out.
Took her out?
Yeah, the chief ordered us to drop the case. The victim decided against pressing charges.
And you say a little kid took her out?
Yeah, I had the bail ready in cash. 10 grand.
Holy moly.
It's all right, though. I took the cash from him, I screamed in his face real loud, and even sprinkled some crack on him. Extorted his ass. Now that is some fine police work, Burbank.
Any idea where they went?
Not a clue. But Duquesne, if you do find this Castrato guy, make sure you got backup, all right? I mean, obviously don't call us if the guy has a penis. But if he doesn't, that's about enough to bring him in right there.
Do you have the contact information for the victim? Desmond Spatch, the victim, lived in a one-bedroom apartment off of 158th Street, downtown Burbank, basically Harlem.
Who is it?
Dick Duquesne.
Are you a police officer?
No, I'm a detective.
I close the case. I'm a normal man with a normal penis. Good day.
Wait a second.
What?
I'm just trying to figure out if someone bought your silence.
Bought my silence? Play the tape of me going through with the case. You think I want the headlines reading Desmond Spatch, castrated art critic, rectified?
I'm not talking about your rectum. It's your penis I'm after. So you're staying quiet out of shame.
I have no penis. Let me leave with some dignity.
And if anyone asks you, tell them I have a penis.
I turned around and noticed a little ruffian scurrying quickly out of my line of vision. I trotted down the steps after him. I banked around the corner and he was gone. Was I being followed? When I arrived back at my office, night had fallen. I sat at my desk, admiring my Luger, Bessie. Six-shot, revolver. Just like the one Sister Tracy trained me with. The gun she was holding buried her. She would take me into the shooting range and talk me through it. Put your hand on the trigger, look at your target, take a breath, and tap. Guns aren't all fun and games, though. It was late. I put Bessie back in the drawer. I switched my patches, and I went to bed. You could almost hear the sound of the Burbank subway running beneath us. Almost.
I'm fucking serious, man. I didn't say nothing.
I believe you, Maya. I really do. But I need to be sure that mine is the only story that anyone has. Now, no one saw you come here tonight, is that right?
Why does that matter?
Just answer me, Maya!
No. No one saw me.
Great! Next question!
I woke the next day and headed back to the church. I wanted to talk to Sister Mary, see if anyone had heard from Maya at all since she got out. Was that rascal from last night the one that bailed her out? I was about to find out. As I exited my office, I saw the bugger putting dynamite in my mailbox. He gave chase. I wasn't about to let him get away this time. He was a good deal ahead of me, but he was staying mostly to the sidewalk. Luckily, I'd been running marathons since age 15, and I could gain on even a rapscallion of his speed. I cut through an Italian restaurant. Hey, get back here! My shoe!
See ya!
The 6th Street staircase! 3 floors up!
Take that, old man!
Gah! Throwing coins at me! Come on! Come on, kid. It's just you and me up here.
That's what you think, hunky bitch.
And right before my very eyes, he took his little jacket off and used it as a zip line, jumping off the building and landing on the lower rooftop of the circus tent across the street. Lucky for me, I was wearing the belt that Song Kim Chun gave me when I learned kickflips and hopping during my 3 years in Siam. And that belt is just like me, unbreakable. I took the same path to the circus as the rapscallion and searched the crowd for his face. I looked to the majestic elephant, and there sat the boy like the most badass thing I'd ever seen. Hey! Elephant! Slow down! Who's that boy on your back? After trying every trick in the book, it seemed that this boy had bested me. I took the escalator down and headed to my office to get a clean set of clothes. Did I mention I fell into a great deal of elephant poop? Anyway, what was waiting there for me was some grim news. Sister Mary, what are you doing here? Why are you weeping?
It's Maya. She's been killed.
It never rains in Burbank, but it does get gloomy. And this was a gloomy day. Pastor Tom gave a chilling memorial. Some of the orphans eulogized her. There was a dance-off. I took third place.
Crazy day, eh, Duquesne?
Show me a day that isn't crazy, and I'll show you a daisy that's full of shit.
Coroner says they did her in with a pair of garden shears.
Jesus Christ.
Isn't that awesome? Good day.
What? No, good day.
Where's little Bobby?
Who?
Little Bobby, our youngest. He missed the whole service, the whole ceremony.
Probably off chasing tail. That's where I'd be.
During a funeral?
Good den, sister, detective.
I was just telling Detective Duquesne how devastated I am that Bobby isn't here to... say goodbye.
It is sad. Youth and death never did mix well, Detective.
Well said. Good den. The way he looked at me like he wanted to help me. I would have believed every word out of his mouth if it wasn't for the spitball I felt hit the back of my neck. Ah! I looked around and saw waving in the distance the rascal from before.
Oh, there he is. Bobby. Bobby!
That's Bobby?
Yes.
You're not running from me this time. Come here! But he wouldn't. He beckoned me come to him, putting his finger to his lips. I quietly ducked out of the procession, tailing the young gentleman through the cemetery to the street.
Not here. Your office.
He looked cold. He looked sad. Not the sprightly youth that had taken me up 20 flights of stairs like it was nothing. He looked worn. We arrived at my office, and he looked at the blinds as I poured myself a drink. How old are you?
9.
You want some whiskey?
No, thanks. I'm good.
Suit yourself, kid. So what's with the cat and mouse?
You want the castrato?
Sure.
I can give them to you. I need immunity. Can you get me immunity?
I'm sure you haven't done anything too crazy.
I've picked up over 25 severed dangles.
If you can tell me his name, I can make you a case.
It's Pastor Tom.
What? I hadn't quite thought it through yet, and it surprised me a great deal. Right under my nose. The nice guy that corroborated the nun's story.
He paid me to do all sorts of stuff. I followed you because he told me to. He was scared you were getting too close to finding out stuff about his whole operation.
Prostitution.
No, these girls never sleep with anyone. He's just a sick psychopath searching for pretty dicks via pretty chicks.
You're blowing my mind here, kid.
I'm telling you, I don't know why he's into this stuff. As a child, I do not understand.
Now, wait a minute, son. If you were in this deep, what made you come back out again? Why turn on the Castrato?
Because he killed my sister.
Maya Brown was your sister?
Damn right. Only family I had left. And now she's dead.
She was a loose end. She's dead because I visited her in prison. I asked the pastor about her, and it's only fair to assume that once he saw this loose end in his operation, he had to cut the end. Loose. Because it was a loose end.
Okay. If you can get me immunity, let's call the cops on this motherfucker right now!
Hello?
Lieutenant, it's Dick Duquesne.
What can I do for you, white detective?
I've got good news. We've found the Castrato. How come it doesn't happen when I do it?
Really, you found him where?
The 6th Street Church. It's Pastor Tom.
Hell, I'll be damned. You got proof?
I got a young boy here who can tell you everything you need to know, as long as his immunity is promised.
I'm afraid I cannot help you, Duquesne. I can't go off some kid's word. I need probable cause, real proof. You've got proof he was tied to Maya's murder? You've got proof he had communication with her at all? A picture of them together? Call me when you have something. Anything. You have my number, white power.
What?
What? Good night.
No dice, kid. We gotta find a way to prove that it's him.
Like how?
Like we catch him with his pants down.
I don't think that'll be easy. He's one of the most loved and famous men in all of Burbank.
You forget who you're working with, kid. Dick Duquesne, a private detective who still has his penis. I'm an institution! People know me, kid. You don't know. I shot the man who tried to kill David Burbank.
Damn. I never even shot a gun before.
You what? You're 9 and you've never shot a gun? You're kidding me. I was starting to like this kid, and I figured, what the hell? I was younger than him when Sister Tracy first took me out to the firing range. So, I set up some cans in the backyard. Now, don't get excited. Remember, the gun is stronger than you. Keep your eye on the target, take a deep breath, and tap. Bullseye!
You missed completely.
Your turn.
Keep your eye on the target.
That's right. Steady. Take a breath and tap. You're a natural!
Oh, shit, I'll get better than you! Woo! Man, I've tried really hard never to touch one of these things before.
A gun?
My friends die every year because of these things. I started working for the pastor because I love making music. I want to fill the world with harmony and clarity and speak to a generation. Not die in the street because of some weird pimp with no penis.
Hey, kid. Dreams are important. Don't lose that dream. And you're not gonna die. Not if I can help it.
Same to you, honky. See you inside.
I still didn't know what a honky was. A goose, maybe? I don't know. Didn't matter, though. I had a plan. The next day, Bobby and I headed to the church with one goal. Expose Pastor Tom for what he really was.
Jesus had a son, bet he had a few. And that son had a son, had a son, son that led to you. I bet you never knew, I bet you never knew. But Jesus had a son, and that son was you.
Thank you, brothers and sisters. It has been a long week. I thank you for your donations and prayers. Until next time, oh, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Oh, that's a rotten mama.
He's not even bringing anything new to it. He's just doing an Elvis impression instead of having a personality. I embodied that king. This putz.
What?
Nothing. We should think about taking the stage.
What, white man? This white guy said he wanted to take me into his van?
Hey, is that Dick Duquesne?
That's right! I'm a kid snatcher and toddler thief! and I'm gonna grab this child and abduct him to a place off the premises.
Pastor Tom, help me!
I chased Bobby down to the front of the stage, where the pastor stood surrounded by churchgoers. There, Bobby ducked behind the pastor. Everyone spread out of the way as I walked forward.
Now, detective, I'm sure you can calm down before taking this dear child.
Listen, pastor, you're the only thing between me and my day job of being a gentle child abductor. You will feel my wrath. In that moment, it all felt like slow motion. I wound up my right leg and kicked him swiftly where his manhood should have been. A muffled thud is all that was heard.
Owie, ow, jeez, my testicle.
Damn, that looks hella fake.
And now, to prove to all of us, pull down your pants and show us your Johnson. You heard me, Castrato. Seriously? Ugh, there it is, finally.
You're drawing a weapon on me in my church? Everyone get down, this man is mad!
I know what you are, and I know what you are! So it wasn't my strongest moment as a detective. I had pretty much blown it all completely to hell. When I saw a man getting away with so much, surrounded by adoring followers and fans, pissing on the name of the king himself, I guess I just lost it. My eyes turned a fiery furnace red, and I came to as Bobby and I were thrown out of the church. Alone, again, without a plan.
This is literally all your fault. You know that, right?
Sometimes things need to fall apart to come back together again. Somebody important said that. Maybe Jesus.
Doubtful. Jesus said a lot of stuff, but he didn't say shit like that.
Yeah, you're probably right. I'll be honest. Today has been one of sheer embarrassment on my part. Wait, say that again.
Jesus said a lot of stuff, but he didn't say shit like that.
No, after that.
That's all I said.
No, you said sheer embarrassment.
You said that.
Fooey to who said it. It's the answer. Maya was stabbed to death with garden shears. We find those shears, we have our evidence. We just need to get back into that church.
I'm not so sure about this. Last time I saw you two together, you said you were kidnapping him.
I know this is hard to believe, but Pastor Tom is the one behind all the missing girls. He's the pimp they're all working for.
We just need you to get into his quarters and grab his torture toolbox. It's under his desk to the left.
Oh, I don't feel comfortable doing this, boys. I respect the pastor, and if he's really a killer, then aren't I risking my life too?
I know, but if he sees either of us, he'll kill us on sight. You need to trust me. I'm a good detective. This is all to prove that he actually killed Maya. I know it's scary, but it's for justice. He is a very bad man. Think Satan and the devil combined. And I'm going to bring this satanic devil to justice. But I can't do that unless you help me. Trust me, if you listen to my advice, you'll be fine.
For Maya.
For Maya.
Papaya. Sister Mary took up in our cause and went back into the church. Watching her go, I couldn't help but feel a little responsible for sending her to what could be her demise. Whatever, Bobby did most of the talking. Hours passed and we started to get worried. We slowly crept up to the side of the church, and right as we hit the corner, bam! Pastor Tom was leaving the church from the side entrance. We jammed back to the other side of the wall and laid low until he was far enough away to be out of earshot.
He must be going on his evening constitutional.
How long do we have?
20 minutes, tops.
So we took off. Me to the nearest payphone to call for backup, and Bobby to see what happened to Sister Mary. I was following close behind. I knew we were going to find something there, so I had no problem lying to the cops.
What have you got for me, Duquesne?
A room full of penises. I'm talking wall-to-wall Johnson, swinging to and fro like deli meat. You gotta see it.
At the 6th Street Church?
We're running out of time. I took off down the street like a bat flying out of a cave that was lit on fire.
Detective!
Sister, thank God you're alive.
Help, please untie me.
In a moment, sister. Did you get the shears?
No, he has them with him. He caught me, tied me up. It is him. You were right.
Bobby was right. Where is he? At this point, the sister pointed my gaze to the southernmost wall, a large painting from floor to ceiling. It slowly creaked open and Bobby's head stuck out.
Guys?
And I'll be damned. He opened the secret door to reveal a room full of penises. I'm talking wall-to-wall Johnsons. Must have been a lucky guess. Talk about opening the right door. Lucky fuck. I mean, come on! I've opened so many doors, and he opens just one? Oh, God, whatever.
Oh, my. I can't look at this.
There must be 70 penises in here at least. This proof enough?
Let me get my camera out.
I see you found me out, detective. Stay where you are or I snip the sister's neck like a fresh Christmas bow.
Let her go, Pastor. I'm not afraid to shoot you down. Gun beats scissors in this game, Sonny.
I'd like to see you try. I've got a human shield.
He had me in a corner.
Where's Bobby? Is he in here?
It was at this moment that I realized that Bobby had closed the door to the room of deli meats and Pastor Tom hadn't seen him, which meant one thing. I was covered from behind. From my time in the Orient, I'd picked up several different martial arts moves. Judo, knuckle sandwiches, groin kicks. But my favorite move, the Duquesne trachea chop. Before the pastor knew what hit him, I chopped his trachea to pieces with the inside of my right hand. But this only got him away from Sister Mary. We tussled, and the pastor got behind me in the shuffle.
I'll kill you both! I'm the Elvis of Burbank!
No, you're not, you piece of shit! And with that, I threw him with all my might to the side of the room, right in front of the cupboard full of penises.
You're really an idiot, Duquesne. Now I've got two weapons.
Bessie! My gun!
I've been two blocks from your office running this game for years, and you catch wind of it now? Now, when my collection is finally perfect? Look at it!
My heart pounded for Bobby as the door slowly opened. I knew his number was up. Nobody wants to see a room full of Johnsons, unless they're selling baby products at some sort of family company expo.
What?
I had his attention. Looking my way, pointing the gun right at my chest. As the door continued to creak open, I caught a glimpse of Bobby, and he slipped out of the room just in time. Behind the desk, he crept toward the pastor's safe.
Behold my masterpiece! 76 men, 76 trombones, soon to be 77, all walking around the world like me, feeling how I feel, sexless, fixed!
The pastor, transfixed on his dong closet, held Bessie pointed at my chest. I slowly started to move, and he quickly turned toward me. I took a few quick steps to the left, got him looking back at me as Bobby kept working on that safe. Now, just look at me, Tom. You don't want to kill anyone.
You want to know how I got like this? I'm not even a pastor. I'm not even Catholic. My parents were both Jewish. And when I was 8 days old, you know what happens to a boy when he's 8 days old?
Jesus Christ.
Shut up! He gets circumcised. We had a bris, but the moil, the goddamn moil was drunk, and he snipped too far! He snipped too far! The son of a bitch snipped too far! You will never know turmoil till you're at the mercy of a drunk boil. Come here, detective! Come here!
Ah! He yanked my arm close to him in his masterpiece. Throwing me in the room, he turned to Sister Mary, still tied up in a chair.
Sit tight, sister. I'll deal with you soon enough. You know, detective, what you said before was right. I don't want to kill anyone. I just want to set all the penises of the world on fire and even the score. You can empathize with that, can't you?
Not really.
Too bad. Now I'm going to cut your dick off.
I've never been so scared in my life. How would I introduce myself? A dick? Dick Duquesne? I'm a private dick. A detective. Without a penis?
Not so fast, hunky bitch!
Bobby! You've got a gun!
All right, kid, let's dance. You wanna point a gun at me? You kill me, I'll shoot your friend here right in the head.
Bobby, look at me. You're the best shot I've ever seen.
You can do this.
Oh, shut up! Put your gun down, Bobby!
Bobby, put your finger on the trigger.
Bobby, put the gun down!
Take a breath.
Shut up!
And squeeze. Nice shot, Bobby!
That's what you get when you make a little kid deliver penises to you? He kills you. That's what happens.
All right, that's enough. That's enough now. All right, that's enough. The cops are on their way. You best scatter.
But what about my immunity?
I'll see to it.
And what about a headline that says, 9-year-old slays pimp and penis thief? That's going to be so fly.
But you don't want that, Bobby. You want a life of music. You want a life of harmony and clarity. Remember?
There is a lot of money in the pastor's safe.
What? If you ask me, it's completely empty.
Thank you, Detective Duquesne. Someday, you'll see Bobby Brown's name in lights. And you'll know it was all because of you.
I know I will, kid. Little did I know that he would buy a guitar and write such hits as Dust in the Wind, Miss American Pie, and of course, the national anthem. I untied Sister Mary and retold the tale of my heroics to the cops. The Bugle and the Times covered the story, with Bobby completely deleted from it. But he was the real hero. All I did was teach him how to shoot and forget to load my gun, which is why I didn't get shot in the head. Wowie! Ho-ho! Today was not my best day.
It's 3:15.
But it was another case closed for old Dick Duquesne. Another set of doors opened, closed, drunken, men spoken to, women loved, nuns made happy. And for Dick, well, he made it out relatively unscathed, with his penis fully intact. The only thing to do now was get completely obliterated. Dick Duquesne, over and out.
Just make it one for my baby, and one more for the road.
Stidham Incorporated.